You are listening
to the DC Public Library podcast.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Myra Remigio Leonard, and welcome to our special screening of the Frontline documentary, United States of Secrets, Part 1. Today, we are pleased to welcome producer Mike Weiser to discuss his film. We're going to learn about the evolution of the program, which is a top-secret surveillance operation that began in the Bush administration and continued at the NSA until Edward Snowden's revelations in 2013. The film tracks how the U.S.'s fear of another terror attack after 9/11 led to widespread monitoring of its citizens. The screening will be followed by a discussion with Mr. Weiser, led by Char Miller, a professor of political science at George Mason University. This program is part of a larger series of events running through the end of January called Orwellian America, Government Transparency and Personal Privacy in the Digital Age. To learn more about this program, please visit dclibrary.org/1984. Major sponsorships for events in the series have been provided by the Institute of Museum and Library Services. Other program partners include the Black Cat, the International Spy Museum, the Newseum Institute, the Sunline Foundation, the Center for Responsive Politics, IUDA, the United States Federal Trade Commission, and the United States Government Publishing Office. If you are interested in seeing more programming like this, please consider donating to the DC Public Library Foundation at dcplfoundation.org. Also, please consider filling out an evaluation form after the discussion. Your feedback is important for future programming at the library. And Mr. Weiser, would you like to come up and introduce the movie?
Thank you. Thank you all for coming, and I'm looking forward to taking whatever questions you have afterwards. This was a film that aired in the spring about a year after the Snowden documents first leaked. It's part one of a two-part series, and what this film is about was providing a context and a history to what the NSA revelations were, what they meant, and where they came from. And the second part, which you won't watch today, is about the relationship between corporate America, the internet companies, and the NSA. So it's two parts, but this hopefully will provide a little bit of history and context for the NSA story. So thank you for coming.
All right, thanks. So I first want to say congratulations to Mr. Weiser. Last week, United States of Secrets was honored with the 2015 Alfred DuPont Columbia University Awards for Excellence in Broadcast and Digital News. So we're happy to welcome him, co-producer of the film. We're just setting up the stage here, so bear with us. Let me get another chair. I'll be right back. So, by way of introduction, since 2003, Mike has worked as an Emmy Award-winning television producer, writer, and journalist for the PBS series Frontline. His most recent film, The Anthrax Files, looks into the FBI's investigation of the 2001 anthrax letter attacks. Other recent projects have included Top Secret America, an examination of government secrecy and the government's war on terror, and Death by Fire, an investigation into the execution of Cameron Todd Willingham. In 2009, Mike worked on investigations into the causes and fallouts of the financial crisis in a series of films including Inside the Meltdown, Breaking the Bank, and the Emmy Award-winning film, The Warning. In 2008, he served as a producer on the Emmy Award-winning miniseries, Bush's War, a 4.5-hour history of the Bush administration's foreign policy. Mike has also been nominated for a New Approaches Emmy for his role in producing an interactive web video timeline documenting American foreign policy after September 11th. This is Mike here. Leading this discussion is Char Rune Miller. Dr. Miller teaches political theory at George Mason University. He received his PhD from Johns Hopkins University and has published two books on citizenship and state discipline. He's currently working on issues of sovereignty and political theology in an examination of money. Please join me in welcoming Mike Weiser and Char Miller.
Hi.
First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Weiser for such a spectacular job on the movies. Really amazing to put together that much material and to make it so compelling. It's just an impressive piece of work. But before we get to the kind of more, I guess, the nuts and bolts, and I'll let you all ask questions, I do just want to sort of start in the, like, what's it like to put that together, you know, in terms of, like, the interviews, how difficult is it to get the interviews, how much stuff's left on the floor, like, are there good things you can't use at the end, just sort of, like, how do you make such a nice movie, I guess, in my...
Well, this is a story we have been interested in for a long time. During the Bush administration, we'd made a film called Cheney's Law, which was about the administration's claims of executive power. And we knew some elements of the story. We knew that there had been a confrontation at the hospital room, but we didn't really know the details of what was the NSA program, what was going on. And it was only after the Snowden revelations and the documents came out that there started to be a flood of new information. And for the first time, a lot of the people you saw inside the administration who were involved in the program were willing to talk. Because in the months after Snowden released the documents, the government started to declassify key elements of the program. And that's, for example, why Alberto Gonzalez and Andy Card were willing to talk to us for the first time. So it was a project that was definitely a challenge to get everybody to talk to us. But doing it at the moment when we did do it, in those months right after the Snowden revelations, definitely did help us. And yes, there's always things that end up on the edit room floor and things that we can't use. This film, this project actually started out, we were either going to do an hour or two, and ended up becoming a series. There's a second part of the film, which deals a lot more with the details of the relationship between big Silicon Valley corporations and the government, and more details of exactly what type of spying is going on. So we were lucky to be able to expand in order to fit the what we gathered.
Any interviews you really wanted but didn't get?
Well, we've always wanted to talk to David Addington or to Vice President Cheney. But Addington is well known for not wanting to talk about any of this. But that would definitely be, if there was an interview or somebody that we could talk to, it would be inside the Vice President's office. Because they played such a crucial role, not just on this program, but so many other parts of what happened in the years after 9/11.
One more sort of a cinematic question. When you're putting this together, part of it sort of flips over for me, and especially when you go shots of like computer-generated close-ups of DC, and it focuses down on like an NSA building or FBI building, which reminds me of the Bourne movies. So like as you're putting this together, how do you deal with sort of the aesthetics, the sort of politics of the aesthetics of it, right? In the sense of like, I think of the sort of way in which a James Bond movie sides you with the government in certain ways, or other sort of structures of a spy thriller can put the audience in a sort of position with the movie. Do you pay attention to that, or is the structure kind of...
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that is not an accident, and we did watch a lot of spy movies and see how these things happen. And not just to make the story more sexy, but when we first started working on the project, one of the reactions we got, even internally at the series, was, oh, NSA spying, the Snowden documents. A lot of people, I think, would see long articles in the newspaper with complicated details about what exactly was being revealed, and it was something that seemed inaccessible and not particularly interesting. And one of the things that we can do when we're making a film that can be harder, especially in just a shorter newspaper article, is to bring it to life. So I would say even more than the cutting and the music and the effects, it's finding human stories to tell inside this big story about what happened with the NSA program. There were people all along the way who were affected by it and who were having battles over it. And for us, we felt like that was a powerful way to draw people into understanding what went on and why.
Thank you. I was surprised at how interested I was in just like putting it together before we even kind of get to what you're telling us, which I found to be really quite breathtaking and thoughtful and very well done. Are there any questions along these lines that people have right now?
Yeah.
She's got a microphone.
I noticed during the watching of the documentation how Eric Snowden, when he exposed a lot of things that the government was doing that the public did not have knowledge of, his number one tools that he had was documentations to back up what he was saying. And then it also talks about how he studied the lives of all the other whistleblowers, and they had no documentation, even though they were telling the truth. Does that, the fact that the other gentleman and the lady there that didn't have documentation, far as future whistleblowers are concerned, is that the only way that a matter could be brought to light and maybe some justice or some, you know, something could be done to make sure that future situations won't hurt or put other people at risk of the government doing what they just did in that film?
I think that's one of the central dilemmas for people who work in national security, who see something that they're concerned about, is that and one of the things we try to show in the film is that at every stage, secrecy is used to avoid debate and to protect the program and to not deal with the issues. So when people would raise concerns, even inside the government, they would say, you know, you're not authorized to be talking about this program, and there's a threat of you going to prison if you do. And certainly for Edward Snowden, the lesson that he drew was that he needed to have those documents, because otherwise he wouldn't be taken seriously. So is that the only way, you know, that something will happen is if there's documents? I don't know, but I can tell you that I think Snowden drew that conclusion and felt like other whistleblowers had not been taken seriously and were able to easily be dismissed. You know, one other element I think that's in the film that comes through at least a little bit is that when you're having a debate over something that's classified, the government has a monopoly on knowledge about what that is. And can, when the president comes out and describes the program or describes successes from the program, it's very difficult for us as journalists or for the general public to know how seriously to take those representations, which is something that's come up recently with the Senate report on the CIA interrogation program as well. So it's not just limited to the NSA. You know what? I don't have a card, but I'd be happy to give you my email address.
Okay, anybody else, any questions at this point?
Yeah. Looking at this film, this goes on state level, on different levels in the government. So my question is that if a person like me, for instance, believed that the government wasn't holding up to the responsibility, such a thing called the Harper Act. So what I'm saying is, how do a person like me that feel the government's not holding up to their responsibility? There's a lot of cover-up because there's a lot of inside stuff that's going on. So how does a layman like me really touch somebody like the government? Because if you guys, insiders, can't get to them, so it means a person on my level could never get to them without a lot of money. Or is there a way to do that?
I think that it is a challenge when you're dealing with a classified program.
So how do we respond politically to what you're showing us?
Yeah, you know, I'm not sure that I'm probably the best person to answer the question of how do you respond politically, or how do you engage as a citizen. But I'll say one thing, looking back on this story in particular, was that there were along the way parts of what was going on that were revealed. There were stories about the domestic interception, or the intercepting domestic telephone calls. There were stories about collecting metadata. There were certain constellation of stories that were out there, and each time they would come up and the administration would respond and the story would sort of go away. So I think the only practical advice I could give is to take on the difficult work of combing through what is being reported and what are all of the elements of, you know, whatever the story is that are being revealed. But as far as a political response, I'm not sure I'm probably the best person to answer that, but it's a good question.
Yeah, just sort of following up on that briefly, I mean, a sense of, because I don't know, after watching the entire thing, I was kind of interested in, well, what do we do about this? Which I thought provoked a couple of points, one of which is the sort of massive transformation you're talking about. At the point the government can copy all of the internet and maintain that. I mean, you've got a real transformation in how people exist as citizens vis-a-vis the government and how the government recognizes them or has to respond to them. And I thought the movie did a great job of sort of not leaving you at a sort of cynical moment there. But it also seems like there's no easy answer. But in sort of a specific, I don't know, one more kind of, maybe it's just the same question over again, but there's a place where Diane Rourke says, oh, if this gets out, all hell's going to break loose. And I kept kind of waiting for all hell to break loose. And I kind of keep waiting now for all hell to, like, why aren't people more angry about this? Or, you know, in some place you can say, like, they are. Indeed, like, frontline, you've made a doctor. Like, that's a big response in some ways. But in other ways, it feels like there's not that much response to what, I mean, Nixon's out of office and Obama and Bush have never been more popular, you know, in a kind of disappointing way. I don't know if that was a question or
I mean,
a rant.
I think part of that, just to go back a second before I answer that question directly, is that one of the things that happened was that 9/11 coincided with a dramatic change in our own use of technology, with email, with instant messages, with the creation of Facebook, which comes a few years later, and we start producing more and more data, and we start to become more and more used to that data being collected, whether it's by Silicon Valley companies. You know, a lot of people, when Gmail was first created, there were ads that would be related to your email messages and to keywords in your messages. And people said, this is outrageous. You know, nobody's going to stand for this. And privacy advocates were upset. And in the end, the public seemed to have moved on and to accepted that they were okay with Google's computers reading your emails in order to put ads. So I think there's been a change in the last 15 years since this program was created about our own expectations of privacy, and that has played into that response. But it was definitely, there was the confluence of those two events of 9/11 and the creation of the technology that will allow tremendous amounts of data to be created and then to be gathered, led to the situation where we are now. And it's an interesting question of what would our privacy expectations look like, you know, if 9/11 hadn't happened, if we had just been creating this technology, would it be in the same, would we have more concerns about the government creating programs like this?
Good, thank you. Yes.
I want to say this was totally riveting. I feel like I learned so much and got so much insight and has made me even more paranoid than I was before. I'm concerned about the role of the media, particularly the New York Times, in basically suppressing information that would have affected the election, the second of George Bush. I was actually shocked to realize this was happening in the first administration by Bush. Anyway, so my question is, what explicitly does the government hold, what hold does the government have on the press? In other words, what kind of threats could they have made? And my assuming their threats were made. And secondly, I don't know really much about the political leanings of the new owner of the Washington Post, but I wonder if you could talk about that and how that might affect some of the choices they make about what to publish.
Sure. So on the first part, I'm not sure what, you know, whether there was a criminal threat that, you know, that they could threaten to the New York Times, but really the argument that the administration made to the Times was an argument that was not only made to the New York Times, but was made over and over and over again in the Bush administration, and continues to be made by the Obama administration, which is, if classified information comes out, people will die. And I think that was the argument that for the Times was a crucial element of the reason they decided not to publish the story. The other argument that the administration made was that the program was legal. And even though there had been so much controversy inside the administration over the legality of the program, the editors of the Times accepted that argument. Some of the reporters who had worked on the case and who had heard from people like Thomas Tam about, you know, the sitting attorney general being indicted made the argument, no, we're hearing from our sources that this program is not legal and that this is something that's important to the public interest. So I don't know about any particular threat of the, you know, government coming down, but one of the things that did spark the publication when it did was the New York Times received word that there was talk about an injunction to stop the newspaper from publishing. So that was another threat that was out there, and the Times ends up putting the story on their website in order to avoid that possibility. And I'm not sure I can speak to Jeff Bezos or the Washington Post, but these decisions that the New York Times makes in the film are decisions that the media and newspapers and magazines make frequently, and were certainly making a lot at this time when they came into possession of classified information.
Okay. Both administrations used the argument that this avoided any future threats or any additional terrorist threats. In your work in researching this, was there any evidence found that indeed these programs have mitigated any of these potential threats?
Yeah, the examples that the administration cited have not been especially strong, especially, it depends on which element of the program that you're talking about. On the most controversial element of the program and on the gathering of domestic telephone call records, I don't think that there is clear evidence that it has prevented attacks. The argument that is made by General Hayden and by others is that when you're doing intelligence, you're gathering from lots of different sources, and one of the things that they were able to do was to rule out that there would be an attack, so they would have a telephone number, and they would say, well, we knew that that guy didn't call anybody else in the state, so, you know, he said to us, I would want to have that authority. But it is a good question, because that was one of the arguments that was being made at the time. I think if you look at the recent Senate investigation into the CIA interrogation program, it's a very similar question that they have there, where the Senate spent, I think, $6 million in 7 years digging in, trying to answer questions about claims of efficacy. So those are very difficult questions to answer inside a classified program.
Considering what happened with Drake and the others, can you speculate as to what might happen with the Snowden case in the future?
I can speculate, though perhaps I shouldn't. I don't see there was talk that there might be some sort of a deal if Snowden had something to offer, but from everything that we heard and people we talked to, it doesn't seem like at any point in the near future there would be that the government would be willing to drop charges against Snowden just because of the signal that it would send to others inside the intelligence community who might be contemplating a move of their own. It's very important for the intelligence community to prevent more incidents like Edward Snowden. So it is hard to imagine that he would be allowed to return and welcomed with open arms. But I don't know.
You don't say anywhere during the movie that the Supreme Court has not yet ruled on whether or not that program is legal or not, that it's still simply controversial whether or not it's legal.
That's right.
You don't really make that point.
We do not make that point in the film. I mean, a lot of these decisions that the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court were making were obviously decisions that were made with only one party represented. because of the classified nature of them, there wasn't an opportunity for anybody to challenge these decisions inside the government, which is something that's come up since the Snowden revelations.
So you're presenting a controversy and not a fact that anyone, in fact, has violated any law and has gone to jail for anything that you've said in this movie.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, just want to make that clear, that no one in the intelligence community has gone to jail or been convicted of breaking the law for doing what they've been doing.
That's right. I mean, okay. The people who have been indicted are people like Thomas Drake.
Yeah, but they're whistleblowers. They've been indicted for breaking the law against breaking their oath of office and for leaking classified information, which is against the law. Correct?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, second of all, you don't mention the which the Director of National Intelligence has brought to our attention many times, the incredible damage to our sources and methods of gathering intelligence that these revelations have made. You don't mention that either.
That's right. I mean, and there's many, many things that we don't mention in the film.
So you didn't present a balanced account.
Well, we did. What we decided to do was to look at a particular part of the story and to look at what led up to the Snowden revelations and what was the politics and what was the history of what had happened from internal whistleblowers who'd had concerns about the program, how that history developed and led to the moment of Edward Snowden. You know, whether Snowden was right or wrong is not something that we even try to address in the film.
Well, if you don't address whether he's right or wrong. Second of all, next, you don't address that. He revealed his information in two communist countries, Hong Kong and Russia, and he's hiding out under the protection of Putin in Russia. You don't point that out either.
Well, actually, the second part of the film does continue the Snowden story
and
does trace his journey from Hong Kong. So we bring him up. In this film, we bring him up to that moment when he makes the decision that he's going to leave.
So I would just look for, it would be very nice if people like Frontline and people like you would actually present both sides of the story, because there's been tremendous damage done to the intelligence community and to Europe, and the fact that the intelligence community spends many, many billions of dollars a year protecting your right to do what you just did. It would be really nice to hear that story.
Well. Let me just respond to the idea, to this question about, you know, telling the other side of the story, because what we were trying to do in the film was to understand how the program was created, what the controversies were, how it led to the Snowden revelations, and you know, that's why we talked to people like General Hayden, to Alberto Gonzalez, to let them explain what was going on at the time, what were the decisions that were being made. So we tried to have people who are whistleblowers, and we tried to have people inside the administration explaining why they made those decisions, why they thought that those decisions were right. You know, the controversy over Edward Snowden and whether he released too much information, shouldn't have released information, how he released information and where is a very interesting story. And it's one that in our history of the creation of the program and what led to it, we just weren't able to address. But thank you.
In the back, like, yeah, right here. And then the gentleman back there.
I noticed in the film where Tam talks about going to the metro station and making the anonymous call from a payphone, and I just recalled one time when I was looking for a payphone in a metro station, none of them worked. and at first I thought, oh, okay, people are using more cell phones now, maybe it's not as cost effective, but I'm curious whether you know or can speculate about any evidence of payphones perhaps disappearing because it's harder to trace where the call came from.
I have no information in the regards to, you know, payphones and where they went. I suspect it has more to do with cellular phones. And that was a different time when he made that phone call, and the technology has definitely changed a lot since.
Right. Yeah. Right there.
Thank you. Hi. Was there any specific example that led Hayden to expand to domestic? Any specific inciting incident, as opposed to just expanding to foreign intelligence surveillance?
Well, the incident was 9/11, and these programs were created in the immediate aftermath of September 11th. So there wasn't another terrorist attack where they slowly started expanding the program. This was all created, the groundwork for it, the groundwork for all of the elements of the program were really laid out in the middle to late September and began to be implemented by October of 2001. And the history that follows is a history of the program changing and morphing, but the groundwork goes back to September 11th.
One of our librarians has a question.
Okay.
At one point, Barton Gellman mentions that Hayden is, when you interview him, he sort of has a habit of sort of eluding your questions and being sort of, kind of tells you what you want to hear. And I was just wondering if you found that to be the case, or if you found him to be, more forthright interview subject, or how did you find him to be?
Oh, well, that's a good question. On one hand, Michael Hayden is a great interview because he's willing to talk to us. He's one of the people from the administration who's always been relatively open to the press and willing to talk about what happened, which is not true about other parts of the Bush administration, and in particular, as I mentioned, some of the folks near the vice president's office. He's also very colorful and tells concrete stories, which are great to, which are great to have in the film. So he's useful for us in presenting their side, but he's also he will also say, I can't talk about the details of these programs because things are classified. So it is sometimes hard to evaluate when you have an interview subject who's got a great knowledge of classified information and they're telling you a story. You have to sometimes go back afterwards and look at what they tell you and look at what you know about what happened and then draw your own conclusions from that.
Ms. Chilford.
Thank you. I have another question concerning the, what I gathered from your whole project that you put together there is that abuse. When it shifted to the community and started gathering information on the community, I agree with national security and devices put in place to protect our homeland. I agree with that. But also, there's a small fraction of possibility of abuse where I'm watching you, and I have a lot of power because I'm in charge of this program, and I'm watching you. You don't know I'm watching you. And I make up in my mind, I don't like the color of your socks. Then I can make your life miserable if I want to. That's the part of the abuse that that Eric Snowden, I think, was compelled and motivated to say, okay, they doing this kind of stuff. It's good to get Al-Qaeda and all these different kind of people that's trying to hurt us, but the average Joe that goes to the chicken shack to get a piece of chicken, and that could be... If you jump on him, that could be considered as abuse. And I think that's why he was compelled to do what he did. He wasn't trying to be an enemy or trying to bring down the country. I think he was trying to alert the community that you have rights and you need to be aware that you have rights. And when they're violated, you should be made aware that they've been violated.
I think the question of how do you oversee a classified program is at the heart of, to avoid abuse, is at the heart of this story and is at the heart of the reason why Edward Snowden came forward. And I think that's a balance that we're still trying to figure out, and we've been still trying to figure out in the 13 years since September 11th.
I thought it was also nice in that, in some of what you alluded to there, and this wasn't a main focus of the film, but the way sort of self-presentation of being brave kind of functions and our expectations of what it is to be a brave citizen. So Snowden can kind of come off brave because he's clearly taking this huge risk in doing this, whether you agree or not. I mean, there's a sort of ennobling moment in that. And Hayden's sort of self-presentation, like when he tells a story about talking to his wife, and he's like, it's all going to come out and it could be bad. And there's a sort of kind of evoking this sort of bravery in their actions, which I sort of enjoyed in a kind of the way it moved around and you approached it in different directions.
Yes, Mr. Weiser, I'd just like to congratulate you on a very compelling cinematic telling of a story that America should have heard and needs to continue to hear until we get fired up enough to do something about it. The gentleman was alluding to the fact that he felt it was a one-sided story. I don't think so, because what I was hearing, I hadn't heard before. Vice President Cheney, President Bush, even President Obama have had and continue to have a bully pulpit to justify the actions of this program, which is still in existence. And I believe the money that was quoted in 2008 was what, $8 billion on this program? Okay, so 2008, this is what, 2015? So that's what, 8 years, 9 years down the road? How much is this costing of taxpayer money to spy on Joe Blow down the street, the guy that owns the McDonald's, you know, the email? I mean, and if this, you know, I'm a patriot. I want to protect my country. But it didn't stop the Boston bombing. It didn't stop the terrorist attack in France. And we've got so many wars going on, it's hard to keep count. So apparently, you know, that idea, if you reveal this, you're going to have blood on your hands. That's a powerful deterrent. It may not necessarily be the truth, but who wants to risk that? Because we do have enemies. But yet still, you know, they're taking our privacy away. Where you have to be careful. There was a saying in the 60s, just because you're paranoid doesn't mean they aren't out to get you. And I guess my question to you is that I think you may want to advance this discussion, because I think that's what you've done. You've allowed, right here in the heart of the capital of the free world, you've given us an opportunity to really ask some serious questions. This program is still going on. This is not like we're looking back on something that used to be. This is still happening right now. With my money and all everybody's tax money is in here. But yet we have homeless people sitting out on the sidewalk. We don't have affordable housing. We don't have employment the way we should. We have elements of our government that consider the citizenry to be de facto possible terrorists, which is why they want to collect all the better data on us. You know, so that's kind of it's an Orwellian, George Orwell's chickens have come home to roost in 2015 right here in the United States of America. So that's the only thing I had to say.
I think the question of the efficiency of the program is an interesting one, and it's one I don't have a good answer to, but some of the people that we spoke to, some of the critics of the program, say you can talk about the privacy issues related to the program, but that one of the things that concerned them, some of the NSA insiders, was the fact that it may be distracting from actually getting the information that you need. One of the examples that everybody in the intelligence community is always talking about is finding a needle in a haystack. And one of the criticisms of this program is that what it does is it creates thousands of haystacks, because you're gathering so much information that some of the people inside the NSA who are critics of the program told us, you know, that the time and effort would have been better spent having analysts focusing, you know, on understanding particular targets rather than gathering everything, there may have been missed opportunities because of how much data was being collected and how overwhelming that data was. I mean, there's so much, the NSA can gather much more data than it can actually process. And so that's one of the challenges that they face right now.
Just as the gentleman said that the government's collecting metadata, and I sort of thought that part of the show was like, it's not just metadata, it's actually kind of everything. And so when both presidents are saying, both Bush and Obama are saying, like, we're just collecting metadata, they're lying, because that's not what they're doing.
Yeah,
to ask kind of bluntly.
The content element of the program has changed in the last few years, and it started to change because of the FISA court, and it has modified. But the metadata collection is the part that is definitely has continued. And I think one of the things about metadata, if you don't know what metadata is basically your call records, your internet traffic when you visit a website. It's not saying necessarily what you're emailing, but it's saying who you're emailing, who you're in contact with, and it allows them to do a very sophisticated analysis of who your associates are, when do you contact your associates. So a lot of people we talked to said, you know, that metadata that many people say, well, if you're not reading my email, you know, it's fine that you have that metadata, but that metadata can provide an incredible, incredibly rich information about who you are, about who your connections are. I mean, that's something that's explored more in the second program in the series.
Anyone else? Yes, sir.
My question is there evidence that there has been abuse of this data, aside from inefficiency?
There are reports that have come out of access to the data, and I'm not that familiar with it. I know that that the DNI has released some incidents where there's been unauthorized access, where somebody was in the NSA was looking up a girlfriend, things like that.
Just over here.
I'm sorry I'm late. I'm just getting here, and I caught a little bit of what was going on. Man. And my question is why? And the reason why I'm saying why do you have the metadata, like you just said, why even the terrorists don't like us, if you want to go that far? You know, why? Is it something that we, as the United States, have done wrong? You understand what I'm trying to say?
I'm not sure I do.
Why? Why?
I mean, I think the answer to the why question of at least why the program was created and why all this information was gathered was you definitely have to go back to those days after September 11th when the country was in shock, when there was a real fear of another attack and a belief that, you know, anything that can be done needs to be done. And that was the roots of the program.
Could you also respond to that with in a kind of different way, but the, like, part of the why is, like, they can, right? I mean, because at one point they've got this program, and suddenly people get to have a reason to use things they've worked on and not been allowed to do, which I wanted to point out just to kind of raise the question about the drive of the technology itself. Right? There's a way in which, okay, we're not going to do it, but the moment we want to do it, we can do it again, because the technology, you don't unsolve the problem of how to accumulate all this data. Which kind of, again, connects back to the problematics of how do you change things in a world where we're also imbricated in the technology and it's there and it doesn't go away, even if you sort of make it illegal for a while.
I mean, that's right. This information is not only being gathered by the government, it's also being gathered by private corporations and in a level of detail and specificity that was just not at all possible when most of our communications were telephone calls or satellite calls, and you had to have somebody sitting at a cubicle listening in on a particular target, which was what the NSA traditionally did. And once you're able to suddenly gather every call record and every email record and do keyword searches for information that may be related to a terrorist investigation, for somebody like Michael Hayden at the NSA in those days after September 11th, it was hard to say no when that technology was available.
And you?
Hi. How much of the program has now been declassified, and how much of what you've shown us through this is still classified information, and how did you get these guys to talk about it?
Well, a lot of it actually ended up being declassified after the Edward Snowden revelations. So the DNI has now released, I don't know what the current count is, but certainly thousands, if not tens of thousands of pages of documents about the program. So there's now court opinions and other things that have been released. And that is why a lot of the people we talked to were willing to talk to us. It was not because of the Snowden revelations, but because after the Snowden revelations, details about the program were finally declassified. And so they were able to talk to us about them.
Thank you.
You mentioned private companies, and so there's supposed to be safeguards in place to keep the government from collecting all of this information on its citizens. How or if or do those safeguards protect from these private corporations such as Google that collect information like every time that we send an email or type in a search? How do these safeguards help us, or do they help us?
It's not an area of my expertise. It is something that's discussed in the second film, which I didn't work on. But my general understanding is it's part of your contractual relationship with the corporation. And those, long licenses when you log onto a website or agree to something, there's details about what information they can collect inside there. But that's about all I can answer on that.
Anyone else? Any other questions?
I have a question. How do you choose the projects that you're working on?
It's a dialogue between us. I work for an independent production company, and we do two or three films for Frontline a year, and we have a dialogue with the executive producer and the deputy executive producer of Frontline. So we'll come up with ideas and talk to them about what's in the news and what stories seem like good stories to tell. So it's really a dialogue between the senior editorial staff at Frontline and us.
Nobody else? All of your questions have been answered.
I'm still a little confused about the current status, where things stand right now. Is this only under war status powers? Is this been approved by Congress? Is it permanent now? Is it under review at some point? Where does it stand? My concern is that we've now put the system in place that could be abused, say, in the next presidential election.
Yeah, the program did end up, it wasn't just, we mentioned in the film the FISA Amendments Act, which did legalize large parts of the program, and there have been other legislation passed by Congress so that right now the parts of the program that are continuing to exist are under congressional authorization, which they were not initially. In the wake of the Snowden revelations, the White House put together a review board to come together with recommendations. One of their key recommendations that led to a battle between the board and the White House was over the retention of telephone metadata, telephone call records. And I was just looking it up to see what had happened to that. And it appears that the administration has decided that wasn't feasible. So as far as I know, there hasn't been a change, at least in the telephone metadata program.
So do you think it's permanent?
I think that a lot of the elements of the program, they haven't all continued unchanged, but a lot of the elements of the program have continued under different authorities than they were before. And so I think it will be hard for, any White House to turn off something like the telephone metadata program and face the risk of being blamed if there's another attack.
It does sort of hit on another problem I thought that was nicely illustrated, the problem of kind of the way in which Obama runs against this program until the moment he has this program and then could not possibly give it up, which again kind of puts another barrier on how would you remove these kind of powers from a presidency. Any ideas?
Yeah, one of the interesting parts about the story is how late it was that Congress got involved and provided legislation to authorize it. It wasn't something that happened just in the few months after September 11th when there was great fear of another attack. Congress got involved in, I think, 2007, 2008, which was pretty late, that they finally got briefed on the program. Some members of Congress said they didn't fully understand what was going on at the time, but the politics of it are fascinating.
Any other questions? I have kind of two, and I think we already know sort of what your next project is, though I was walking up the stage and didn't quite hear it. So I'd like to hear about what you're working on now. I'd also like to hear a sort of hypothetical, like, If you got to make a sequel to this movie that's just your project, what would you do? What would you follow up?
I might duck the question about what our next project is, but as far as a sequel to this, I do think that the story of what has happened with the Snowden story and what has happened inside the politics in the year since is a fascinating one. In a lot of ways, you know, at the beginning, I think Snowden was worried that he would come out, it would be one story and it would go away. And it didn't quite go away as fast as I think he was worried that it did. And it did penetrate our understanding of what was going on, but it didn't lead to a sea change in this program or in how the NSA operates. So the story of that, of the reaction to that, is a fascinating one.
Okay, thank you very much. Again, I'd like to thank you on the behalf of all of us for putting together such a fine piece of work and spending the afternoon talking to us. Thank you.
Well, thank you, and thank you all for coming.
By the way, if you'd like to view part two of the film, you can find DVD copies at DCPL locations or stream it at pbs.org/frontline. We'd also appreciate it if you took the time to evaluate our program. Your responses really help us plan better for the future. They're located on that table over there, and there's some golf pencils if you want to fill those out. The next program in our Orwellian America series is a Tor browser workshop, which is being held in the Digital Commons Dream Lab across the way right now. If you're interested in browsing the net anonymously, you can check out the demonstration as we speak. This program is one in a series that will be taking place over the next 8 days or so. We encourage you to explore the other offerings that will be happening at locations throughout the city. And thank you so much for coming. We really appreciate it.